I would just like to begin by asking all of you to remember the Shahada who were killed in Pakistan last Friday. We got the news after the Friday prayers, and the purpose and the reason they were killed was only because they were the Shias of Ali ibn Abi Talib in the masjid on Friday Juma time. Let us please recite salawat and fatiha for them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also grant speedy recovery to those who have been injured in that incident. For today's khutbah, very briefly, I would like to mention that, you know, the news today from Ottawa is that the Supreme Court of Canada has issued a ruling which allows assisted suicide in certain situations. The Supreme Court has given the Canadian government a year to write the law and get it passed through the parliament. Of course, the Friday khutbah is not the forum, as far as time is concerned, to talk about it in detail. I'll just say very briefly that from the Islamic point of view, and I'm sure many other religious groups, including the Catholic Church, would not agree with this process of assisted suicide. Because from the religious point of view, especially when we look at from the Islamic perspective, suffering is part of life. And of course, Islam has a perspective about it, what it means when we talk about suffering. And how should a human being deal with that? Yes, it is a suffering, but from the Islamic perspective, our existence doesn't end with death. We believe in the hereafter. And whatever we do here, whatever decisions we make here, and how we handle the challenges of life here has implication in what will happen to us in the hereafter, which is an eternal life. So inshallah, some other time we will have a more detailed in a different program. We will talk about it. But I would like to just take one concept from that and move to a very different direction. Here the issue is about assisted suicide. You know, basically to kill ourselves. In our hadith, when we talk about the process of spiritual development, tazkiyah nafs, there is a very famous hadith where we are told, mutu qabla an tamutu. Mutu qabla an tamutu. Die before you die. Of course, it has nothing to do with that theme, but I'm just taking that concept on a very different level. And what do the Prophet and the Imams mean when they say mutu qabla an tamutu? Die before you die. Here the word maut in the first statement is actually in the meaning of muhasaba, hasibu qabla an tamutu, which means to take account of oneself. You know, because we know that when we talk about spiritual building, there are different steps that we have to take. The very first one is known as yaqva. In Urdu and Farsi, we'll say bidari. A human being who is lost in a way is in the state of ghaflat. He is heedless. Doesn't care about what is happening to him and what will happen to him or her in the future. But once they have this awakening, yaqva, you know, their eyes open, the eyes of the heart. They realize, okay, you know, I'm not going in the right direction. Once that awareness comes in, a person is, you know, spiritually awakened now, then the next step would be to purify his soul. You know, when we talk about a heart attack, what do doctors do? They put us through blood test and this and that. You know, cholesterol level has to be controlled. You know, the arteries of the blood vessels have to be cleaned. And that is only after awareness. After the blood test and other examinations, we come to realize, okay, this is the problem. And so now we have to first of all cleanse the vessel. And this is where the diet changes, medications come in. And so the first process after yaqba is tawba. Tawba means spiritual purification of the soul from the sins. It is the sins who are basically, you know, clogging the spiritual life for our heart. And once you go through that process of yaqza, then tawba, the third step of spiritual development is known as muhasaba. And this is where we are coming to this hadith. Mutu qabla an tamutu, die before you die, which means take account of yourself before the death comes and the malaika will take the account of your deeds. Do the muhasaba yourself. And this is where it's considered to be a very important step in, you know, developing ourselves spiritually. And so muhasaba or muraqaba, another term for it, would mean to exercise self-criticism, self-evaluation, self-assessment on a spiritual level. Where we are? And this is where we are told, you know, if you look at the hadith that we have from our ma'sumeen, beginning with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, where he says, حَاسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسَبُوا. Take account of yourselves before, you know, your deeds are taken, you know, for account by others, referring to the malaika. وَزِنُوا قَبْلَ أَن تُوزَنُوا. Weigh your deeds before they are put on the scale on the day of judgment. See, it is on, you know, positive side or the negative side. وَتَجَهَّزُوا لِلْعَرْضِ الْأَكْبَرِ. And this is how you will get ready for the presentation on that great day of Qiyamah. We have a hadith from our seventh Imam, Imam Musa al-Kazim alayhi salatu wa salam. Where he says to one of his companions, who was also a very famous companion of the sixth Imam, Hisham bin Hakam, where he says, Ya Hisham, Laysa minna man lam yuhasib nafsuhu fi kulli yawmin. This is for us, for me and you. This is our seventh Imam talking to a fellow Shia, and he says, Oh Hisham, Laysa minna. Those who claim to be our followers are not our followers. They are not from us if they do not take the account of themselves every day. This is the emphasis put by the seventh Imam. فَإِنْ عَمِلَ حَسَنَةً. So when you sit down every day at the end of the day to take account of, you know, what I had done, and then فَإِنْ عَمِلَ حَسَنَةً, and, you know, I look at the list and say, oh, well, I had done good deeds. اِسْتَزَادَ مِنْهُ. Then I should seek to do more of that. وَإِنْ عَمِلَ سَيِّئًا. And if I see in that list of, you know, that day's account that I've done sinful things, أَسْتَغْفَرَ اللَّهُ مِنْهُ وَتَابَ, then this person should ask for Allah's forgiveness and do tawbah. Every day, this is what Imam is saying, Laysa minna. If you are a true Shia of Ahlul Bayt, you had to be among those who take account of themselves every day. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wa salam, talking to his companion Abdullah bin Jundab, he says, حَقٌ عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ يَعْرِفُنَا. Again, you see this ma'rifat of Ahlul Bayt, the love for Ahlul Bayt, these are not only words. Our Imams are saying, if you really have the ma'rifat of us, if you really are our followers, these are the conditions. And even the sixth Imam is putting it this way. He says, it is the duty of every Muslim who knows us, recognizes us, acknowledges us as the Imams, أن يعرض عمله في كل يوم وليلة على نفسه. It is his duty to basically present his deeds every day and every night to himself. This is for self-evaluation. فَيَكُونُ مُحَاسِبَ نَفْسِهِ, so that he can take account of himself. فَإِنْ رَعَى حَسَنَةً إِسْتَذَادَ مِنْهَا, and if he sees something good in it, he should seek to increase in the good deeds. وَإِنْ رَعَى سَيِّئَةً إِسْتَغْفَرَ مِنْهَا, and if he sees evil deeds in it, then he should ask for Allah's forgiveness for it. لَعَلَّا يَخْضَى يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, so that he will not be disgraced on the day of judgment. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, when we talk about this concept of, you know, مُوتُ قَبْلَ أَن تَمُوتُ, yes, the suicide, assisted suicide is a different issue, but on a spiritual level, we need to go through that every day. Just as if, you know, we are going to die now, today, tonight, and take the hisab so that we can make our next day, next week, next month better than what it was in the past. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to be among the true followers of the Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salatu wasalam. إن أحسن الحديث كتاب الله العزيز بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوبة وهو الغفور الرحيم. All praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is all alone and he is al-Halim al-Kareem. Halim means he is lenient when he deals with us. And he is kareem, you know, he is kind and merciful. غَافِرُ الظَّنْبِ وَقَابِلُ الطَّوْبِ, he forgives the sins and accepts our repentance. وَهُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ, and he is the forgiving and the merciful. Remember that. But there are conditions. وَنَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْعَتُوفُ لِلْعِبَادِ بِجُودِهِ وَالْعَوَّادِ عَلَى الْمُذْنِبِينَ بِحِلْمِ وَنَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا نَبِيَّهُ وَحَبِيبَهُ. سيد المرسلين والشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وأولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة. أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة ما سلف من ذنوبكم. To continue this theme of محاسبة and مراقبة, why is it that necessary? I'll just go back to the medical example. After the test have been done, and the doctors say, you know, your arteries are gradually clogging up, you need to clean it by changing the diet, by taking on the medication, you will have to adjust your lifestyle. And then what happens? We can't just leave it at that one stage or one treatment. There is a need for muhasaba and muraqaba. And that's why we have to go every 3 months or at least once a year for checkup. That is known as muraqaba, where you are taking care of your physical health. In the spiritual development, we have to realize the same thing. Maybe in the month of Ramadan, we you know, elevate ourselves spiritually. We feel very good about it. But then after Eid, the spirit is dying out. And that is where the need for muraqaba and muhasaba comes in. You see, shaitan doesn't need to go to the casinos and the bars and other places. He's already put them on that path. As many times I use this term, you know, they put people on, he puts them on autopilot, especially alcohol. He doesn't have to worry about it. It's already, destination is fixed. But he goes to the people who are trying to be on the right path. And this is where the need of, you know, muraqabah comes in constantly to see whether we are being pulled to the other way. The deviation is there. And it is when I do the muraqabah and muhasaba, I come to realize, okay, you know, I'm actually not going in the right direction. That awareness, that muraqabah and muhasaba will push me to go back to the path. And that is why this is considered to be a very important element when we talk about, you know, our development on a spiritual level. And of course, then there are many other steps, but these are the three. The awareness, number one, the process of purification, tawba, and then this process of constantly being vigilant when we look at our own spiritual state. One or two ahadith on this issue again. This is from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is especially at the end of the day. You go on the bed, put your head on the pillow. إِذَا آوَيْتَ إِلَىٰ فِرَاشِكَ. When you are settled down on your bed, فَانْظُرْ مَا سَلَكْتَ فِي بَطْنِكَ وَمَا كَسَبْتَ فِي يَوْمِكَ. Then look at it. Look at, you know, what you have put in your belly and what you have acquired from the mal on this day. This is Imam is referring to two elements, you know, our desire for wealth and the desire for things that we like. وَذْكُرْ أَنَّكَ مَيِّتٌ. And remember that at that time, was while you lie down on the bed, as if you are mayyit now. وَأَنَّ لَكَ مَعَاد. You know, you will be put in the grave in the same way. And one day there is the day of, you know, ma'ad, which means the issue of returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salawat upon the Akbar. May Allah keep us away from the destruction of this dunya. And so the Imam says, when you get, you go in on the bed, you know, just think as if that is your mouth. You are in the grave. And there will be a day when you'll be raised. And there you do the muhasaba of what happened in the day. Let me mention here something, especially we are from the Shia of Ahlul Bayt. We believe in the shafa'at of Rasulullah. We believe in the shafa'at of the A'imma. This is not a right given to them because they have done something. This is actually an honor and, you know, privilege that Allah has given to them. It comes with their status. And so we have that assurance from the Imam that we will be there to help you on the day of Qiyamah. But then there are many, many ahadiths from our Imams about the era known as the era of Barzakh, the time between death and the day of Qiyamah. And there the emphasis that the Imams have for their Shias, especially, is that you have to be extra careful about huququn nas, the rights of the fellow people. Because that is an issue. We believe in Amir al-Mu'minin to be adil, isn't it? We believe Rasul to be adil. We believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is adil. If I violate the right of a fellow mu'min, for example, how can I expect them to erase that for me? Because in doing that, they become, na'uzu billah, zalim in relation to the other mu'min. And so we cannot sit down there thinking, you know, well, I am in the good books. First of all, you're not even sure about that. This is what you think. And so, huququn nas is very important. When we talk about this issue, how we, you know, deal with one another, starting with the family members, with the relatives, the friends, the community members, the human being outside. You know, huququn nas is a very important element, especially in the Shia madhab, that we have to think about it. It is not only the maal of other person which is muhtaram and sacrosanct, and it's not only the nafs and the life of another human being which is considered to be sacrosanct, you cannot violate. Even the dignity of another human being is muhtaram. And we have to think about it. These are the issues where we will have to face the consequences in the grave before the day of judgment. Because this is where the Imam says that we would rather let you go through the adab in the qabr, in the grave, so that at least on the day of judgment, you will have lesser of the sins there and more worthy of getting our shafa'at then. And so we have to think about it. There is no blank check, you know, for Jannat in that way. And this is where the muhasaba comes in. Another hadith on this issue from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Where he says, Ya Abu Dhar, talking to Abu Dhar, Hasib nafsaka qabla an tuhasab. Again, the same concept. Take account of yourself before others take your account. فَإِنَّهُ أَحْوَنُ لِحِسَابِكَ غَدًا. This will help you and make your accounting on the day of Qiyamah easier for you. وَظِنْ نَفْسَكَ قَبْلَ أَن تُوزَن. Weigh yourself as far as your deeds are concerned before your deeds are to be weighed on the day of Qiyamah. وَتَجَحَّزْ لِلْعَرْضِ الْأَكْبَرِ. And get ready for the great presentation in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for judgment. يَوْمَ تُعْرَضُ لَا تَخْفَ عَلَى اللَّهِ خَافِيَةً. And on that day, nothing will be hidden from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing at all. You know, in Surah Luqman, the words that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala quotes from Luqman in his advice to his son, he says, even something as small as a khardal, a mustard seed, will be brought in your front of you. And well, you know, this is also what you had done. As small as that. And the ayat goes on where Luqman says, it doesn't matter whether it's hidden somewhere in the sky. Those days, there was no concept. But now we know whether it's in satellites or in the space station or in the planes, whether it's hidden there or down deep in the earth somewhere it's hidden. It will be brought. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring down. إِلَىٰ أَنْ قَالْ. Until the Prophet says, يَا أَبَا ذَرْ لَا يَكُونُ الرَّجُلُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ حَتَّى يُحَاسَبَ نَفْسُهُ أَشَدَّ مِنْ مُحَاسَبَةِ الشَّرِيكِ شَرِيكَهُ. That a person cannot be considered to be among the righteous people, among the muttaqeen, until he has severely taken account of himself more than the partner taking the account of the other partner in business. And the business, when partners take account of one another, they are very severe. And Rasulullah is saying, be even more severe in that on yourself. فَيَعْلَمُ مِنْ عَيْنَ مَطْعَمُهُ وَمِنْ عَيْنَ مَشْرَبُهُ. So that he can know where did his food came from, what was the source of his drink, وَمِنْ عَيْنَ مَلْبَسُهُ. What was the source of his clothing? أَمِنْ حَلَالٍ أَوْ مِنْ حَرَامٍ. Did it come from the legitimate and halal means, or did it come from haram and forbidden means? يَا أَبَا ذَرْ مَنْ لَمْ يُبَالِي مِنْ أَيْنَ اِكْتَسَبَ الْمَالِ لَمْ يُبَالِ اللَّهُ مِنْ أَيْنَ أَدْخُلُهُ النَّارِ. A person who doesn't care what was the source of his wealth, halal or haram, The Prophet says, Allah will not care from which door of Jahannam he puts him in. And so remember this. This is a reminder for myself and all of you that, you know, make this a habit. That at the end of the day, we take the account of our own actions. And inshallah, that will help us in becoming better Shias, better Muslims, and better human beings, inshallah. اللهم صل على المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وعلى إمام المتقين وأمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام وعلى أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة بن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان ما حيا صار البدي والطغيان هادم أمنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فر البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آبائه الكرام ما اتصلت الليالي والأيام اللهم عجل فرج وسهل مخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.